So I'd just like to thank their organizing committee for their efforts in making this 33rd annual FIRST conference possible and giving me this opportunity to share my topic. I think importantly, thank you for deciding to join this breakout session and hear me speak about gaining CISO support and improving security operations situational awareness with threat briefing. So I'll just continue. So who am I? Probably just go through very quickly. I'm currently a staff threat intelligence analyst for VMware based in Singapore. Most of my career, including now at VMware, my roles are internal facing. So within the organization across information security and technology, in the last 5 years, I focus on cyber threat intelligence. And I'll be sharing my personal experience. I do not represent any views of any organization or the environment that I work in. So I'd just like to share many times, executives from senior executives, including the chief information security officer, the CISO, within an organization would ask, can you share relevant details of this current threat? Have you confirmed, how does it impact us? What mitigations have we put in place to protect us from the attack, that we are seeing that's impacting other companies? A lot of times the CISO asks you this question because there's concerned executives from the board, from the shareholders that may have asked CISO about this. And therefore, the CISO is asking you so that he or she can provide this answer to the required stakeholders. Another time we see is that the regulator, could pose the same question, to a bank, if you work in a bank, or a customer could pose to a technology company. So in a case like we are in VMware, because customers are using your software, they are concerned, can you tell me more about these threats and attack? What are you doing to address this? Finally, of course, as an organization, in turn, we also ask our supplier, also our vendors, what's the data or systems that you have hosted for us exposed in a recent attack that we found out, impacting your organization? So this has been a common question because of the recent supply chain attacks. And as cyber incidents, security incidents impact companies' operations and their share prices, there is a need to answer all these questions. And this is something that, yes, the threat intelligence team can answer, but yet it can also be answered by a member of the incident response or the digital forensics or the blue team. And I'll share with you in my presentation how we can proactively prepare these answers to these questions. So, CISO, threats, risks, and priorities. Prevention starts with knowing what is relevant, relevant threats that could impact your organization. The CISO, the security operations team, do not have time to read daily threat intelligence reports from reliable sources or information. All these relevant risks should be brought to their attention before it affects the company and to gain their support for following up mitigations or address the gaps. So these are common threats, attacks that CISO has expressed interest in. So what I'll be sharing in this slide is something that they have commonly asked about. It is not exhaustive, and you should customize one such list for your company and for your CISO. For example, a security incident with attack details provided, could you share more about it, because it has targeted, or affected, various companies that are based in the same country or in the same industry that we are from. So for example, if you are a bank, and this attack has impacted another bank, in the country you're from, for example, in Singapore, then it's possible that your organization would ask you, can you provide more details about this? And they would ask something like, because of systems that previously your vendor has hosted data on, has experienced a security incident or a data breach. So they would want more information about the attack and more information about what the mitigations we have. Or if there are instances where you have vulnerable systems, systems that are previously infected by malware attributed to a particular adversary or threat group, this is something that, would come of interest to the CISO. Or any of the vulnerable systems that are being exploited by adversaries, You know, it could be the same type of systems that are currently being managed on-premise or on cloud, but managed within your organization and used within your company. And this kind of risk tends to increase if the systems are internet-facing and they face critical vulnerabilities. Finally, one of those areas that of interest always is any restricted or confidential data that is accessible without access control or has not been approved, which means to say it could be unknowingly published or it could be shared but not approved to a group of individuals, hence could result in a data breach. So all these threats that I've listed here is in the order of frequency that I've observed, the different types of intelligence reports have been reported, whether is it paid intelligence or open source free intelligence. But importantly, this is a living document, something that should be created for your organization to mention all the possible threats that could impact your organization. And it's a living document that you should update to suit your customer, your company's needs. These threats also would impact your security operations team as they align to the priorities of the Chief Information Security Officer. And now you know what to look out for. What is the proposed? The proposed delivery method is to conduct a threat briefing. But before I dive into a threat briefing, what details do you need to provide in order to prepare for that? First is that let's have a concise threat analysis set up. So we want to keep the details short and answer the purpose of the attack. Okay, you want to keep it short, if possibly, between 40 to 70 words. You want to explain what is the operating system, what is the application versions that are affected, what was the data that was compromised or exfiltrated, what are the specific common vulnerabilities and exposures, CVE, that was exploited in the attack, what is the impact, possibly what is the impact of the malware that would impact the affected system. Now, under assessment, you want to include how is this relevant to the company? So you want to specify actions you have taken to verify that this attack or this threat has impact to your environment, has impact to your organization. You have checked that the affected systems are in use. You have reached out to teams to verify that. So these are details that you can provide in the assessment. If there were indicators of compromise provided, you can also include the IOC sweep that you have done to identify potential impact. Now, if there are any gaps that would impact the assessment or to verify the impact of this threat, you should also indicate the gaps. Therefore, the CISO has attention on what he or she needs to support, what's the action required, and as well as if there's any decisions that require the CISO to make based on risk. This is an area that you should also indicate that. And then finally, we'll touch on the impact. So what we are interested to know is what are the possible attack surfaces, infection vectors, attack vectors. What other mitigations or preventative actions that you have applied to address these same techniques? What are the malware that was used in the attack that could potentially be deployed in our company, in your company? For example, do you want to block command and control domains, that's on the firewall, block or monitor detection, processes, detection of processes and techniques that's used by that malware, by setting up those use cases, alerts on the endpoint detection and response. So with that, we want to ensure that when you present this threat analysis, for a threat briefing, it should be kept to 3 minutes. By having a very concise threat analysis, it reflects that someone within the information security team is following up ongoing threats. And even if there are no risks to the company, the CISO will want an update that an action was taken to verify that. We have checked, there's no impact to us, verify that there's no relevance to our organization. So I think that's a confirmation that someone needs to do to ensure or give an assurance to that aspect. Now, I'd like to give an example. If dark side ransomware falls under the threat priorities, risk priorities that I've mentioned earlier and relevant to your company. Now, this example reflects a concise threat analysis like what I've mentioned earlier. And I have actually, obtained the sources based on CISA and FireEye. So For example, in this case, I'll give a very short statement, you know, stating where was my source, what am I looking at, and I'm interested if, for example, if you're a US-based company and you are in energy, oil and gas. Now, having this point to state that Colonial Pipeline would actually be of interest to you because it's probably your partner, you know, one of your competitors. And if it has impacted the organization, you'll be interested to know, does it impact you? And because it's such a widespread activity, you'll probably be interested because it's also based out of US if your organization is based out of there. And the proposed attack was mentioned to say that it's because of data encryption. It's a ransomware. It also does data exfiltration. So these are information that you want to include in your summary. Not too much, but enough to explain what does it do. What are the risks to the organization, to the CISO? It's a financial loss if you pay out the ransom, or there's a data breach and you can receive fines for that. And what was the impacted systems? Windows and Linux operating system. So, of course, what are the assessment you could include? You could include what is the relevance to this attack to your company. So for example, if you find that because you are in based out of US, this was widespread, you could mention that that was the case. And other indicate, because of indicators of compromise was provided, you could indicate that a check was done based on the indicator sweep. There was no suspicious activity found in the network logs. And I've not mentioned here, but also in the FireEye report, there was mention of this particular CVE 2021-20016 was exploited for initial access. So if this product, SonicWall, is being used in your organization, you have a vulnerable system, you could also mention that, you know, when was the patch applied, so that, you know, the CISO would have a sense of assurance that at least from that attack vector that has been addressed. Other controls you could also mention, general controls, you know, if this was a Tor router, if you do not use the Onion router in your environment, in your company, you could block web traffic to exit and entry nodes. So that, you know, that's another level of general controls, not specific to this attack. It is being used, but it can also be used by other threat actors for other attacks. Now, finally, impact. So there was always an interest to mention on how does it impact your organization? How does it impact your company? We would include the mitigation specific to the techniques that the malware that used in this attack. So for example, when we refer ransomware, is it currently being blocked by policies on your endpoint and detection and response systems? Is the processes, you know, is there a detection alert that was created for related processes? Is it being monitored by security operations team? And obviously, one of the most common ways is, do you block those file hashes that's being used, either on the endpoint detection or the domain names on the firewalls? So I think that these are typical preventative action, very specific to that malware, very specific to the activity. Now, CISA has provided a list of mitigations that you can deploy that's applicable to your company. I have not included all of them here because various organizations may use different tools. For example, they use RDP, Remote Desktop Protocol, and you can't actually block that outright if that's being used. If not, why not? So that's that kind of applicability when you refer to mitigations that you can put either in your assessment or your impact. Now, with a threat analysis, this concise analysis that's done, you want to collate and combine them. So what is the intent? Now, I mentioned about threat briefing. Okay, the intent is that you want to collect this threat analysis you have done for different attacks that is of relevance to your organization. You want to organize something that's weekly or fortnightly. It depends on your CISO's preference, on his or her availability. You want to keep it to 5 threat analyses because you don't want to exceed the session to make it too long and make it ineffective for your CISO. You want to have an opportunity to build a rapport with your CISO to find out what are the threats, what are the concerns that, you know, impacts, concerns them. Subsequently, you would like to address them by looking at, you know, future threats. If they come up, that addresses those concerns that your CISO have. You want to provide the updates in a similar fashion that we did for threat analysis, in a concise threat analysis fashion. This all is preferably done either in person or over video, because you want to give the CISO an opportunity to ask questions, clarify what you mean, you know, in your summary, in the assessment, in your impact, and as well as you want them to give you also advice. For example, if you have missed out a certain area of mitigations that could have been applied, this is something that, based on the CISO's experience and engagement with different stakeholders, that is something that can have been provided for you. So threat briefing itself is different from incident briefing. The intent is to be preemptive. We want to be proactive and not reactive. So this is so you want to show the actions that you have taken, you know, to the CISO. You provide a form of visibility, you know, that you are actually following up on ongoing and active threats. You want to provide update that, are we affected by those threats? You want to update them, are the security tools blocking this activity, this malware, this malicious activity, and as well as what have you put in place to look out for or to prevent this from happening. So if there is any gaps that you have faced during your course of either providing mitigations or preventative actions, this is the moment, this is the session that you want to inform your CISO so that they can either provide you that support, provide you that resource or initiatives, you know, for you to drive through so that those gaps get resolved. So based on my experience, this kind of threat briefings have been commonly sought after from CISOs, from executives. This is across various industries or organizations, and they want it more regularly than incident briefings. Because from there, the CISO is also informed of the trends that's happening and what are the defenses or the lack of that is related to these threats. So I would say, like, what is the benefits now, you know, covering the aspect that they would actually have an understanding. Is this gap something that, you know, top of mind for the CISO, for them to address? If not, at least they are aware. And, you know, is there a collaboration, a need for different teams in information security? Sometimes it's not just the security operations team that needs to be involved, but the engineering, as well as the governance team. So these are opportunities that the CISO can suggest. Of course, if outside of the information security division, you need to work with different business units or the engineering, the desktop support, the server teams, the applications team, this is also the period that the CISO would advise, is this a doable initiative? Finally, you want the CISO to be aware of the current threats, and if they are not able to address them because of the gaps we have, because this is a business requirement that we need to fulfill and we are not able to address those risks, then there is a risk acceptance that from the CISO point of view, you know, the CISO is able to accept. Now, I think that the main gist at this point, what I want to share is that all along this you know, focusing on the CISO support is one main benefits that, you know, an operations team can gain by providing a threat briefing and update to them. How about, you know, to the security operations? So now, if you are a blue team and you're not from security operations, you're from either incident response, you're from digital forensics, but you do not have a threat intelligence team. Security operations would still benefit from a threat briefing. And in the next couple of slides, I'll share what is the benefit that they will achieve. Now, first, in the threat analysis provided to them, it's not so longer the concise version. It will be the operational version. Now, I'm interested in the attack details. So I would like to know what is the indicator of attacks, what techniques are being used. If you can reference the MITRE attack ID, because a lot of times MITRE attack framework is being used, that's helpful, as well as tactics, what was attack surface, what data was used, was exfiltrated, what data was being utilized, and was there any actively exploited CVE or zero day, or what malware? Usually, in this case, operational level, malware is always something that we always cover. And the difference between this and the CISO version is that there's only two sections. You give the summary and you give the assessment. Why? Because for the impact, you probably wouldn't know it till you have done a search or a verification. So, you know, the assessment would probably only have information that you do at that point when you do this briefing or this analysis for the security operations team. So it's very much, if there is any current gaps in terms of we know that we are not able, we have do not have visibility in certain environments, these are the gaps that you want to mention. If what are the action you have taken to determine, you have verified with vulnerability management team that we do use these systems, we have this version that is in place, we verified the network team. What are the indicators of compromise sweep we have done? Did we see any activity? Which stakeholders have we notified? So this is more of like a high level follow-up action you have taken before you share this threat analysis with security operations. Now, that being said, we try to keep it within 5 minutes because running over time is not going to help security operations team to stay focused on you know, the details that you're sharing with them. So ideally, you should keep it to 5 minutes. Now, once again, I bring back dark side ransomware. So now you see the example, it's a bit different this time. We would include what was the initial access, what was CVE, what protocol was being used, as well as what was the encryption method, encryption key that was being used. Now, why do we want this? Because if the security operations is able to do searches, that they know that RDP is not being used. Now, that this could be used as a use case to detect suspicious activity. Same for Tor. Now, if they are aware that that we do not use this particular encryption key, these methods within the environment, this is something that they could also do a detection or even a block. So this is very much, you want to write or provide information to them that they can use for detections, for threat hunting, you know, for blocking, for prevention, things that they can use for action. Now, what about the assessment? If you have run a sweep and you found out that there was no activity, you could mention that. Same for the patch. If you are aware that after following a vulnerability management team, the patch was updated on, was fully patched since which date, you want to put it down, as well as other follow-ups you've done with other teams to put in blocks. So I would say that this is an example that how it is different when you are providing that same threat analysis to your security operations versus your CISO. Now, you same thing, you collate that, you know, take 3 to 5, you know, because you want to keep it within 25 minutes. So if each so threat analysis is 5 minutes, you want to keep it within 25. If there's 5, you want it to be either weekly or fortnightly because you don't want them to be out of touch. So you want to receive you know, feedback from them to understand like, hey, is this something that you find useful? Is this information sufficient for you to take action on, to go search for the activity on our EDR or on our network logs? So this is the kind of purpose that you want. You want to highlight trends and tell them the new tactics or techniques that, you know, attackers are now using. You want them to be vigilant, to be suspicious, you know, what they should defend or to be cautious about, so that when they are doing their day-to-day work, they are aware of that and, you know, do further analysis, you know, before deeming that it is a false positive. So the intent is to be proactive during early stages of the attack, because it is more effective and costs less than later stages when the action objectives is met. So such threat, I would say threat briefings have been found to be very useful to security operations team, you know, across various organizations, because they don't have time to read threat reports daily from various sources, even if they are reliable. So, you know, this gives them a heads up of potential attacks and, you know, they get informed of available defenses or even the lack of defenses if we have any gaps. So I think that this is the intent. You want to keep it also in person or via video, so that it is interactive for them to ask questions, clarify if needed, so that you also know what do they get interested in about to do the future threat analysis and threat briefings. So I'll just touch on, you know, some of the benefits, you know, of having this. So the security operations team would now be able to analyze techniques and processes and understand that, hey, you know, this sequence of activity is something that could be of a malicious intent. They are aware of the current trends that's occurring in the industry, external environment, impacting other organizations, other industries as well. And perhaps, you know, what gaps do we have, or foresee what gaps do we have in future? So I think this is something that, you know, of benefit to them, because they are the one that's handling the analysis as well as, you know, following up the cases for incident response to do further analysis. The next is that you want them, it is an efficient action, because you want to give them, you know, actions that they can take, you know, to run the searches with the tools that they have in the environment that they have. So being efficient in that space for them by, you know, just only covering information they need in the summary for that threat analysis, it definitely is much more useful than giving them a full-blown attack report. And then finally, it would help them to know whether they need to engage other divisions, you know, other teams. It could be within the information security division, you know, engineering teams, governance teams, vulnerability management, pen testing, or do I need to go out of our division, you know, touch on other business units if there's a need to work with HR or even different engineering teams, you know, IT support, because there is a need to do that. So I think that this entire session would give them, this threat briefing would give them that thought, do I need to do this in future? Is this something we foresee? So you also give them that level of future planning. Finally, I think that I'll just like to give a takeaway that threat briefing is a very efficient way to bring attention to analysis that you have done, mitigations you have applied. So it can be risks or gaps that you have, but definitely you cover the threat analysis because it was relevant, you know, to those risks that your CISO have expressed interest in. And it also highlights the techniques and tactics that the security operations team need to be vigilant about. Therefore, even if you do not have a threat intelligence team, a dedicated team that does that, any member of the blue team, which is the incident response, the digital forensics, even the threat hunting team, you know, can always prepare and deliver a threat briefing, you know, that is relevant to the chief information security officer or the security operations team. So with that, I'd like to conclude my presentation, and I just return back to Olivia.